Hi everyone, Tardisguide123 here, and today I'm going to be reviewing The Seeds of Death, the classic second Doctor story featuring the Ice World. What? Seeds of Doom? You mean I've been watching the wrong story this whole time, and you didn't tell me? But now I've got to go watch another 6 episodes, can't I just... Fine. Hello again everyone, TARDISGUY123 here, and today I am going to be reviewing The Seeds of Doom. This review was requested by Elizabeth Powell a very long time ago actually. I'm sorry this has taken me so long to get out, but it's finally here. So thank you for the request, and I'm sorry I didn't get around to this sooner. But anyway, here it is. Here is what we have. We have the Fourth Doctor, we have Sarah, both of them arguably at their best. We have Scorby, a wonderful hench villain. We also have Harrison Chase, a wonderful arch villain. Some people say he's a bit camp, and yeah, I guess he is, but it works, it fits the tone of the story, and I'll get more onto him later. We also have other wonderful supporting characters, Keela. We have the Krynoid, which is its only TV appearance, a wonderful plant-based creature, which would later go on to appear in Big Finish Hot House with the Eighth Doctor, and it doesn't feature the Brigadier, because he's in Geneva. It doesn't feature Benton Ealer, because of unknown reasons. It doesn't feature Harry. It does feature some unit personnel, but it's not quite the same about them. We'll get onto that later too. But anyway, here is the front. There is the spine. That's the back. That's disc 1, that's disc 2, which for some reason on mine constantly falls out. Front of the booklet, back of the booklet, and the inside of the booklet. So without further ado, let's talk about the story itself in all its glory. We start off in the icy depths of Antarctica, where a couple of scientists unearth a strange pod-like thing, and this is of course the Krynoid pod, a little pod which causes a lot of trouble for the Fourth Doctor and Sarah, and indeed for the whole world. And it starts off very simple in sort of like the icy location, and you really could have had the whole story there, really. And in fact, if it wasn't for the presence of two pods, we could have just had this as a nice little two-part story, and it would have been very self-contained, a very well-done story. But instead, we then carry on into Chase's estate. And there's a helicopter outside, which is really annoying me. But we then move on to Chase's estate for the final four parts, and this is where things get a little bit more interesting, where the story really gets going. We have the second Krynoid pod, and this is where things get really interesting, and I think that structure works very well. You know, sort of having the two-part story followed by the four-part story, it works quite well. You get the threat set up in the first part, with the first pod attacking someone and whatnot, and then slowly changing them into a Krynoid. You get to see that transformation, you get to see what's going on, and then when you see these people messing about with the pods in Chase's estate, you really understand their threat already, you know what's going to happen, and therefore it racks up tension even more, and you really want the Doctor and Sarah to stop that happening. And even then, where you've got the two-part and the four-part structure, you could even argue it's a two-part, two-part, two-part structure, in the fact that the first two parts are obviously the Antarctica parts, the middle two parts are very much sort of like the Chase's estate normal parts, so it's very much human villains that are the main enemy, and then sort of like everyone versus Chase and Krynoid itself in the final part, where it's fully germinated and attacking everyone and sort of like making the plant life around it grow hostile. So I think once again that works quite well, and it's nice to like have those bits in the story where everything changes, it gets renewed amount of energy, you get to see a new direction for it to go in. Admittedly, the middle two parts are probably the weakest two parts, really, where it's just sort of like you're just waiting for the Krynoid to get into action, really. It's just sort of like killing time, you know, building up to that. Would I say you could have got rid of those two parts and just had it as a four-part story? No, I wouldn't really, because I think it's sort of like necessary to have that slow build-up in some ways. But at the same time, you know, they aren't the strongest, they aren't quite weak. It's very repetitive in the sense that it's the doctor and Sarah running about, getting captured, splitting up, one getting captured, the other getting captured, the other freeing the other, etc. It's very much that sort of direction that they go in. And you know, it works. You know, I think there's a lot of fun to be had there, nevertheless, with some wonderful characters involved in these chases, but at the same time, it is quite repetitive from an objective point of view. So yeah, I would say that much about those middle two parts. Going backwards a bit now to the first two parts, as I say, they're very much just set up for the story, the introduction to the Krynoid, what it can do for the most part. We also sort of have the introduction of Keela and Scorby, who are two wonderful characters. You know, you've got Scorby, big tough henchman, leader of them all, who is played by an actor whose name I've forgotten, but I know he went on to play Boise, I believe, in Only Fools and Horses. So that is an interesting little fact for you. And he does the role very well, and it very much fits the actors. John Challis, I believe his name is actually. Yeah, I think that's him. And it very much does fit what he can do. He does it very well. And you know, you have wonderful lines in there, such as when he and Keela are talking in the first two parts, and he's just like, and then he's talking about digging a hole big enough for, say, four bodies, or maybe it's five bodies, I can't remember which, but then he just goes, otherwise I'll just make the hole a little bigger, referring to putting Keela in the hole, obviously. And that's quite a nice little threatening line, very well written by Robert Banks Stewart, and it's just wonderful little bit of dialogue which tells you almost everything you need to know about Scorby, really, at least in those first two parts. Then he sort of like in the middle two parts, this is another thing that I dislike about the middle two parts, they make him a bit incompetent in terms of his villainy. You know, get him set up as very dangerous towards the start, then towards the middle you can see that he's no match for the Doctor, really. You sort of like seeing him tripping over himself to go after him, he gets his neck snapped slightly by the Doctor in one of the chases, and we'll get on to some more of that action Doctor in a bit. But yeah, I think that's quite disappointing that his character does sort of go downhill a bit then. However, it does sort of like step up a bit after that, where you sort of like get a bit more character development in the final two parts, where you sort of like see that he acts all tough and whatnot, but when it comes down to it, he's quite afraid in some senses. And when he comes up against this big Krynoid, you know, he feels out of his depth, he knows he's out of his depth, and that ultimately leads to him sort of like having a breakdown, rushing outside and getting killed. And yet, that's quite an interesting direction for his character to go, but it is quite nice character development as well, in a way that he changes from the start of the story to the end of the story, and you sort of like strip away his layers and keep stripping away until he has that breakdown. But I think that is very interesting. And also those scenes where he's alone with Sarah as well after the Doctor's gone off, and you sort of like see Sarah standing up to him at times. And this is what I like about Sarah Jane Smith. We're now going to move on to her character, and she is wonderful in those scenes with Scorby, because what's his name, the producer before Philip Hinchcliffe, Barry Letts, who cast Elizabeth Sladen as Sarah Jane, said that he cast her because he saw many actresses playing the character scared and many actresses playing the character brave, but he only ever really saw Elizabeth Sladen doing both at the same time, and he could easily see that in her performance. And that very much comes across in these scenes of Scorby, where she's standing up to him, but at the same time she knows he's a dangerous man, and she knows that she needs to be careful not to push him too far in these senses. And you know, I think that works quite well, because you know, it shows her character as strong, but it also shows her character as not invincible, not the most amazing girl in the universe who can apparently do everything before tea. So yeah, that is why Sarah Jane Smith is a much better character than Clara, because if you had Clara doing those scenes, this is not going to turn into a Clara run, I promise. Clara fans, fair enough, but I just don't like how, if she was doing that, she would very much be 100% brave, 100% foolish, just sort of like going, yeah, well, you could just shut up, you're a man, blah 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 blah, that turned into a bit sexist, she probably wouldn't do that, but you get the idea. You know, Sarah Jane Smith showed being brave and brave and scared at the same time, whereas Clara can mainly just show being brave with no real context, and that's why you don't really care for her character, or at least I don't really care for her character. For the most part, she does have other flaws as well. Really need to stop talking about Clara. It's not good for my health. So, back to Sarah, who is of course wonderful not my favourite, but you can easily see why she's become a fan favourite and why she's the definitive companion. Because, you know, she's not just the screaming girl who's afraid of everything. She is very much a brave character. She screams from time to time, but it feels very natural when she does. And also, as Barry Letts cast her for, she can be brave and scared at the same time. And I think there are many wonderful examples of that. And I think The Seeds of Doom, where she is with Scorby, is a very good example of that. The Fourth Doctor, who is much more of an action doctor in this, as I mentioned before. And, you know, you see him sort of like punching people in the face, putting them into hospital, very much being a more action hero, which the story requires him to be, really. And, you know, it's almost like the story is a bit of a Avengers slash James Bond story a lot of ways. You sort of have a James Bond villain or Avengers villain in the form of Harrison Chase, and you know, you have also Scorby, who fits very well into that world. It's almost like one of those types of spy thriller stories with a sci-fi concept in the Krynoids, and you know, that very much takes over towards the end there. But at the same time, the first four parts, you very much see that side of the Doctor coming out in him, and you know, it's very interesting when you look back at some, but watch some Tom Baker interviews from now. So like where he's saying, oh, I like the Doctor because he's sort of like, this is a horrible Tom Baker impression, I won't try it, but yeah, where he's sort of like going on about how the Doctor never sort of like used his fists or anything, he used his mind to be his enemies, his wits. And you know, while it is true for most of his stories, you know, I'd very much love someone to intercouple narrative interviews with clips from The Seeds of Doom of just Tom Baker whacking someone in the face or breaking someone's neck. You know, it's quite amusing, it would be quite amusing to see that and how that would work out. Yeah, I think that'd be quite funny. But yeah, obviously, you know, it shows the threat menace of this story. It shows how dangerous the Krynoid pod is, that the Fourth Doctor is forced to act this way, and you know, he's very desperate, he very much needs to stop this at all costs. You know, it's a race against time. The Krynoid can't be allowed to germinate, spread its spores all over the planet. And you know, you very much get that across with the Doctor in some of his lines, where he's just like shouting at Scorby and whatnot. And there are some wonderful scenes where he's just like, there is no chance. And all those wonderful lines, which Tom Baker delivers very well. So like, he does the shouting very well. And you know, it's this and Pyramids of Mars, where he really does get to let out that side of his Doctor, that serious side, where the threat levels are really big, where you've got Sutek, destroy planets, and the Krynoid that once it germinates, that's it, it's over for the human race. And yet you very much see that threat level coming across here through Tom Baker's performance. He very much shows that this is highly important, that it could be the end of the world. And you know, some people complain about the ending and that it's just sort of like shooting the Krynoids with missiles and that's it. But I personally like that ending. I think that works very well. Is it a very Doctor Who-ish ending? Arguably not, but is this a very Doctor Who-ish story? Not in some ways, as I said, it's more of an Avengers slash James Bond story. And I think that fits that in a way, but at the same time, it also fits the fact that the Fourth Doctor has been telling people, this is dangerous, you need to not do this, you need to stop now, there is no chance. If the Krynoid germinates, it'll be the end of everything, do you hear, even your pension. And, you know, wonderful line right there. And, you know, I think the threat level is very much coming across, but no one's listening to the Doctor for the most part until it's too late. And so he has to use that last resort because he has nothing else available to him. He's tried everything. He's tried to stop this so many times before it happens. And now he's just got to resort to blowing it up with missiles. So I feel that that does work in the context of the story and in the context of the Doctor. And while it is very much underneath everything, it's very much subtext, but I think you can pick that up. That's the way I choose to see it, and you know, that makes me feel better about the ending. And maybe now that you've seen that side of things, maybe you will agree with me, maybe, or maybe not. I don't mind. Your opinions are your opinions, but yeah, that's just my thoughts on that ending and the Fourth Doctor in this story. Harrison Chase, the master of all villains from the Hinge of the Era, at least in my opinion. I think he is wonderful. Obviously, he has loads of good villains in the Hinge of the Era, but Harrison Chase, there's just something about him that is very yes, he's a bit camp, but at the same time, he just works so well at the foreground. So he has some wonderful lines by Bob Baxter. I think the actor, Tony Beckley, I believe his name is, does a very good job with that, and you know, it's not like I can play in my green cathedral all day, and all this wonderful stuff is obviously mad. He's obviously lost the plot somewhere along the line, somewhere. Probably lost it in the garden somewhere, but you know, it's just such a brilliant performance, and he's such a brilliant character as well. Just, you know, he's mad, he's bonkers. But you know, not in the Missy way, where she's sort of like self-aware that he's bonkers. He plays it very sincerely in the fact that he doesn't know that he's bonkers. He just sort of like hates people, really loves plants, and he just sort of like thinks everyone else has seen well from his point of view. And you know, it's very sincere. And you know, there's that wonderful line which is like, "What a shame! I could have had two pods." And you know, wonderful the way Tony Beckley delivers that. I hope it's Tony Beckley. Otherwise, I've watched that. But yeah, just the way he delivers that, how sincere, you can tell that he really meant that sincerely, that he's really upset, and just the look on Scully's face after hearing that is quite amusing as well. And you know, he is a very wonderful villain, very sincere villain. And you know, some people, yeah, he may be a bit camp, but you know, you can get away with that from time to time. He's mad. I mean, you can't really play this character sincerely. He just like works, and you know, it heightens the story. And I think he does do a very good job. Admittedly, he does feel a bit of a loose end towards the end, which is a shame. Really, when you got the Krynoid there, when the Krynoid's taken over, I do feel that his place in the story is lost a bit. And then, but then you do have that wonderful ending to his character, where obviously he's sent into the garden and crushed by his own, compost machine. And you know, there's that wonderful line from Tom Baker, it's just like, "I was trying to help him, and he was trying to pull me in." And just the look on their faces, you can tell they're exhausted, you can tell that he and Sarah have been through a lot. You can tell that they were tortured by that whole thing. And, you know, it's a very strong moment, and even though they were a villain, he was a villain. Harrison Chase was trying to kill Mark. Basically, the Doctor still feels remorse for his death. So, like, still feels churned up by all of that, and tired of all the dying that has occurred because of human greed, ultimately. And I think that is wonderfully done there. Thackeray, who is quite a good character, I will say, you know, not a standout by any means. You know, it's interesting that he does get an offer to go into TARDIS at the end there. But I think he serves his purpose in this story, as sort of like initially questioning the Doctor as being quite mad, but ultimately striking up quite a nice friendship with the Doctor and Sarah. And you know, he's a very good character, very thankless role really when you think about it. But ultimately he is sort of like the Brigadier character in many ways, you know. Forget Major Beresford, so Colin Thackeray, he sort of like fills that role in the story, and I think he does so very well. Speaking of Major Beresford, let's talk about Unit in this story. And obviously it is quite disappointing that they couldn't get the Brigadier in there to fill into that role, even though it would have just been like one or two episodes where he just comes at the end to save the day. It would have just been nice to have him there, really, because it does feel a bit odd having the Brigadier in Geneva both the Android Invasion and this story. And you know, it starts to become a running joke, really. It's just like, "Oh, where's the Brigadier? Oh, he's in Geneva." And, you know, ultimately, for the last Unit story, you know, Unit don't really get a big bang to go out on. They just sort of, like, fade away. And, you know, admittedly, that's not really anyone's fault, because, obviously, Philip Hinchcliffe wanted to move it more into space with the next series. And, you know, with Sarah Jane Smith gone, there wasn't much call to go back to Earth as much in modern day. And so, you very much move away from that. And then, the producer that followed, whose name I am forgetting at the moment, sort of, like, he moves it away even further from Earth, and so you don't really get any more proper Unit stories of the Unit family. And while the Brigadier does eventually return when John Nathan Turner takes over, you don't really get any Unit stories until Battlefield. And you know, that's got the Brigadier in it, but it doesn't really have the same family feel. And you know, so this is sort of like the end of Unit as we knew it during the 70s. And it's not for like a big bang for them to go out on. They just sort of like fade away with the Brigadier and Benton and Harry all together for their exciting Terra de Zygons. And then the Brigadier's off to Geneva in the next story, the Antarctic invasion, and now the final unit one doesn't have any of them in it really, so it just sort of like fades away into the background rather than having a big bang to go out on, which is unfortunate, but you know, that's just the way it is for this story. And so maybe we should be thankful that Benton wasn't in this story though, or Harry, because if they were, they would probably have taken the place of Sergeant Henderson and ended up in the trash compactor. Not trash compactor, it's not Star Wars, it's Doctor Who, it is the compost machine. So thank goodness that didn't happen, I guess. And last but not least is the Krynoid, which is a wonderful idea, a wonderful creation. It's sort of like, it is quite similar to the Wyrd when you think about it. But, you know, I can forgive that because it's very different in some ways. You know, in fact, it's a plant, you know, it's a pod that's been frozen for millions of years. Well, thousands, I don't remember what it was in the permafrost. Taken out, germinates, lays its spores in human bloodstream, and then slowly they sort of like eat that person alive and turn them into a crinoid. And it's not sort of like transforming them in a way, it's sort of like growing off them. And, you know, eating them inside out, and then eventually using sort of like human structures to like become the lumbering axon, crinoid creature we see here. And you know, it's very wonderful, and well, not wonderful, especially if you're the person inside it. You know, it's very interesting how that sort of like plays out, and sort of like how they transform slowly into something that's not even recognizable to a human being there, and sort of like this massive creature that's about to spread its spores all over the planet. And you know, that is very, very nice in that sense. It's a very wonderful creation by Robert Banks Stewart, and you know, I do love the Krynoid. However, there is one part that does annoy me, and that's when the Krynoid talks. Yeah, I'm one of the people who doesn't like that much. I prefer that it's just, I like that it's intelligent. I like that it has intelligence in some ways. But at the same time, I don't like that it talks. That just sort of like makes it a bit more of a standard monster rather than something unique. And, you know, I feel that sort of like takes away the threat level from it. At least for me, it feels a bit ridiculous. And, you know, I feel that it doesn't really add much just to have those few lines of dialogue, I think. Had they been left out, it would have been fine, it would have been a wonderful creature. And, you know, yeah, I can look past it, it doesn't annoy me that much, I still love the Krynoid. But at the same time, I don't like the fact that it talks, that just annoys me, really, for some reason. But yeah, I prefer the Krynoid, it's just this intelligent creature, but also this silent creature. And, you know, that does come across for most of the story. It's treated that way. It's just those couple of scenes that isn't. Honourable mention to the scene where the Doctor, Sarah, Scorby and Sergeant Henderson decide to get rid of all the plants that are inside. Rather than simply going, opening up the door and chucking them out, they run across and put them neatly down by the side, probably because the BBC wanted to reuse the props somewhere. So it's just quite amusing to think that, you know, they've got to get these plants out because they're the eyes and ears of the crinoid. But, you know, let's just lay them down nicely out here, far away from the door, rather than just lobbing them out and letting them die, you know. But then again, I guess you've got to have good reason for them to be locked out by the villainous Harrison Chase. Overall, I do love the Seat of Doom. It is wonderful. It is classic Fourth Doctor at his best, you know. Very strong. Tom Baker gives a very strong performance, as I say, and it is just a wonderful story. Highly enjoyable. You know, it has its flaws, yes. The middle two parts are a bit off. Unit aren't the best in this. And also, you know, I don't like the fact that the crinoid talks. But it is nevertheless, other than that, it's a very strong story. Very well done. Very good characters. Robert Banks Stewart, it's a shame that he only got to write this and the Terror of the Zygons, because both of them are very good stories, and you know, it's a shame that he couldn't go on to write more. Obviously, if he did, we would have got Talents of Winchelang, because of the Foe from the Future was really going to take that slot, but he had to back out and whatnot. But you know, it's a shame that he didn't really get to write anything more after that. So anyway, for the rating, it's a 9 out of 10. The flaws, yeah, they do annoy me. There's not that many of them though. So I can't really take off any more than 1 point. If you haven't picked this one up, highly, highly recommend it. It is very much worth it. And that is all I really have to say. Pick this up as soon as you see it. It is a must-buy for any Doctor Who fan, especially if you like the Fourth Doctor. And maybe if you even don't, maybe if you're not too fond of his whimsicalness, you know, sometimes he does have those moments. You know, maybe you'll enjoy this one because it's much more serious side to him, very much in the same vein that Pyramids of Mars is. So, yes, this is a recommended buy for any Doctor Who fan. Thank you all for watching. Elizabeth Powell, I hope you're happy that I've reviewed this at last. Please share all your thoughts in the comments below, and I will see you all next time as we review The War Doctor, Only the Monstrous. But until then, bye everyone.
What you have done could result in the total destruction of all life on this planet.
What is a Krynoid?
I suppose you would call it a galactic weed.
It's as if he's turning into some sort of a hideous monster.
I'm sending you on a little errand, Scorby.
Where is the pod?
Scorby! If we don't find that pod before it germinates, it'll be the end of everything. Everything, you understand? Even your pension!
Full of good ideas, Doctor.
People are replaceable, Scorby. The Krynoid is unique.
You want me to die?
There is no chance!
Miss Smith will be our subject.